It's day three at the ASX Small and Mid-Cap Conference, and welcome to those joining us today and coming back from earlier days to be with us yet again. We think today we have another great lineup for you through the course of the two sessions in the morning and again this afternoon. The two sectors that we're covering, technology this morning and health and biotech later today. And we think these are sectors that will be of great interest to many, many Australian investors. As for today, we start with six presentations covering technology this morning and a further six this afternoon on health and biotech. Once again, as did we do yesterday, our first three presentations will come to us from the United States, in fact, along the west coast of the US. We're particularly grateful for our presenters to take the time, given the time differences and, in fact, the date differences, to be with us this morning. We're also very conscious of the west coast of America and current events around the wildfire, so we wish all of those, not just our presenters, but they and their communities, very best under those trying circumstances. Unfortunately, it's a set of circumstances that Australians understand very well. My job, as always, is to keep us on time, and that's what I'm about to do. So it's a pleasure to hand over to our first presenter. Henry Albrecht, CEO, is joining us from Washington State to talk to us about Limeaid Inc. Over to you, Henry.
Thank you very much. Thanks, investors. Henry Albrecht here, CEO of Limeaid, calling from the high-tech hub of Seattle area, Washington, in the shadows of Amazon and Microsoft. So whether you're in Melbourne or Perth or Sydney or Adelaide, welcome, and look forward to talking to you about Limeaid today. Important notice and disclaimers, please read thoroughly, and you will have a printed copy as well. Next slide, please. So just a little bit about the company. Limeaid employs nearly 300 people. We're a global organization. We have an employee experience software technology, mobile-first technology that we provide to people all over the world, millions of users in over 100 countries in large enterprises. We pride ourselves on winning awards for our own culture as we are essentially trying to influence and positively so cultures in the face of great challenges to employee well-being, employee safety, connection, as well as recognition and other domains of feeling supported by your company. As a market-leading company, we've been recognized by Forrester and others as a pioneer in the enterprise employee experience industry. And we're a pure SaaS business. About 98% of our revenue is recurring, and we are a $56.1 million US dollar per our prospectus 2020 revenue company. Serving some of the biggest and best companies in the world, and we'll get to that, the customer makeup, in just a moment. Next slide, please. Thank you. Just a market snapshot. I won't read all of these details except to say these are the basics of how we trade on the market. One of the things I will call out is the size of the pipeline. Limeaid, our legacy brand, is known in the States as a pioneer and leader in employee well-being and engagement. We also have a solution for diversity and inclusion, which is incredibly topical right now. We've never seen such growth in the top end of our pipeline, even though we are in a macroeconomic challenge right now. So we're very excited about the future and as a long-term part of the company, as the founder and someone who's been here 14 years, certainly ready to seize and take advantage of that incredible pipeline right now. Next slide, please. Just some of the basics about our business. So when we sell our software to a large company, especially the core well-being product, which makes up the bulk of our revenue, it's over a $600,000 per year sale. We've seen overall when we sell our other solutions, including engagement, inclusion, the average comes down a little bit. It varies a little bit in North America versus Europe and the rest of the world. But in general, this is a high ticket item and of great value to large enterprises. I talked about the recurring revenue and the large customer base. But another thing I'll say is the margins have been steadily improving for year over year over year. We're getting better at the operational delivery of our software across our business and are continuing to grow as a business as well. Next slide, please. Thanks. Just a little bit of look and feel. It's hard to get the idea of software from 10,000 miles away and from a phone, but essentially we deliver an integrated employee experience software. Our brand promises that every employee of our customers knows that their organization cares about them. That could be well-being check-ins, physical well-being, emotional health, financial well-being, as well as social and other work factors, and how do those contribute? It could be pulse surveys about engagement or inclusion with specific actions and content from our over 700 pieces of content that we have in our library. And then proving value to our enterprise buyers is essential. Showing how participation in our program correlates to lower levels of staff turnover, increased levels of employee engagement, and other factors that executives and C-suites are very focused on. I think it's no surprise when you see companies with new leadership who put people first, see better stock result, better business results, and essentially Limate is the footprint for the delivery of that to the large enterprise in the States and beyond. Next slide, please. The fundamentals of the platform, how does it work? First of all, think about updates as a feed of everything that's essential and important that the employee needs to know from their company. Communications capability, employee listening. In a remote work world, in a work, and actually even pre-COVID, almost 80% of workers don't sit in front of a computer and a desk all day. So how do you stay connected and bi-directionally listen and communicate with your employees? Do you have the insights you need to run a large distributed global organization? Can you provide activities, content, and learning so that people can not just see where they are, but improve where they are? Also some social recognition, some social connection, the support of employee resource groups, and other basically ways to stay connected in a virtual world. And extensions is our word for making sure we fit into the broader HR technology ecosystem. Integrations with all the major HRIS and payroll providers, different types of integrations to make sure we can pull the most relevant HR information and company information into a common mobile first interface. Everything we do is designed to fit in the pocket of someone riding their bus on the way to work. And we'll talk about the industries we serve in a moment. Thank you, next slide. There's a trend going on in the world of work where companies are buying different separate solutions for all of these different categories listed here. And while it may make sense at the time for the buyer, it's quite inhumane to the employee to have to navigate not just these nine, but potentially 9 or 10 other systems and have to jump all over the place and remember passwords. And what it leads to is a bad technology experience and a bad employee experience. If you can combine all of these, or many of these, as Limate does now, to deliver a more coherent message about what that company's purpose is, about what you need to do your job, if you can listen and respond to what's going on in the culture, you can have a better, more reactive workforce and better business results. Only Limate has such a broad view of bringing all these things together in a single common mobile interface. Next slide, please. The market opportunity is huge for this. This is a growing market, growing at an estimated 15 to 20% per annum. And of our customer base, we serve a top three technology company in the world, a top three airline, a top three rental car company, a top 10 auto manufacturer, three of the top 20 pharmaceutical manufacturers. And yet we're just scratching the surface of this market with a prospectus forecast of $56.1 million. These are US dollar market sizes. It's an enormous global market. Our strength and footprint is largest in the United States. We have offices as well in Canada, Germany, and individual locations with a few people here and there in Switzerland and Australia as well. Next slide, please. Oh, it's another picture of me. I would just say, just to summarize what's going on in the world right now, we definitely saw a lot of fear in March and April and May. Here in Seattle was one of the first hotspots of COVID-19 in the States. And as you may read in the press from time to time, we have our share of social justice and other issues in the country that you might expect could lead to a slowdown in how enterprise software is purchased. And certainly we saw some of that in Q2 as well. But long-term demand has grown significantly this year, and Limeade has doubled down on the innovation that delivers on our core promise. If you think about a remote workforce, people dealing with children at home, people dealing with health issues related to COVID, companies having trouble reaching and connecting with their employees and keeping them engaged and focused and energized at work, helping people deal with the isolation, the stress, and all of the headache that comes from COVID is something that Limeade's been doing for over a decade. We pioneered this employee well-being space and have expanded into engagement and inclusion and communications at a time when the world needs it more than ever. So we've seen a great increase in demand and really are looking forward to the future as well. Next slide. Here's some outside analysis. So this is from Gartner and Acadian Ventures. The one on the left talks about some of the HR priorities in 2020 and 2021. Future of work, employee experience, leadership, competency development, but specifically post-COVID-19, you're talking about remote working, data collection, or as we would call it, listening, the social safety net for employee well-being. These are top priorities of large employers around the world. And the second index is just meant to indicate that we feel that software companies, or not we feel, Acadian, this analyst firm, feels that has been tracking high-tech companies and watching their accelerated growth, anything related to the future of work. As a cloud-based software as a service or SaaS business, we're poised to see increased growth over time given just migration to the cloud and secular trends going on in the world. Next slide, please. And what we've seen also in addition to the pipeline increasing is a six-fold increase in the level of top-tier media coverage that Limeade's doing. So our awareness is going up, not just in magazines like Chief Executive and Forbes and Inc., but also from some of the leading analysts in human resources technology in the world, like Josh Burson quoted here, talking about Limeade, saying they focus on employee care, perhaps the number one issue companies face right now. Next slide. And one thing we've doubled down on during this challenging time is innovation. Limeade is an organic company. Almost all of our growth has been organic. We've built our own technology. We've invested $90 million US in the platform itself, the flexibility, the infrastructure, so that now we're allowed to deliver these quick market reactive innovations that our customers are demanding and that our prospects are finding very differentiated in the market related to those topics I talked about, employee listening, reaching dispersed employees, as well as recognition, and connecting people to those resources that are underutilized in most large companies today. Next slide, please. And one thing I'm very proud of and excited about is just the distribution of our customer base. We have a strong balance sheet. We just IPO'd in December, so we have tens of millions of dollars in the bank, but also have a really robust, not too concentrated customer base. I would just call your attention to the industry mix on the left. Specifically, roughly two-thirds of our customer base is in a strong defensive industry that's not necessarily affected particularly strongly by what's currently going on in the macro economy. And then we serve very large employees. As you can see, the mix of employees there it skews towards the large enterprise. So there are some really great companies out there, some of which are from your part of the world as well, that have tremendous businesses in employee engagement and listening, but very much focused on the mid-market, the repeatable mid-market sale. Limeade has invested so heavily in serving these complex, very rigidly structured and distributed workforce, different types of workforce populations. It's a unique and defensible position in the market. Next slide, please. Growth for us is simple. Grow in our, add new customers in our core market in North America, as well as in the EU and beyond. expand through upselling and cross-selling all of our different solutions to our customers, build new offerings, and look for inorganic ways to grow. As you saw in that chart earlier with the different boxes, there are a lot of really great pioneering, innovative HR technology companies that are very adjacent to what Limee does, and we will look for the right fit that fits technically, culturally, strategically, and financially, and is accretive to our investors. That's what we're seeking in terms of inorganic growth, but everything else about the growth strategy is intact from the IPO prospectus and is going well. Next slide, please. We've shown consistent revenue growth over the years. These are the first halves. I would just say excited to be part of a growth company. Having seen our growth for 14 years, I would say we always grow. It always depends on how much, but we are in this for the long haul, and we're committed to being a strong leader in the employee experience market, leading with technology. Product first, culture of our organization is extremely strong. We pride ourselves on having the people, teams, and infrastructure to deliver continued growth as well, and that's what we're focused on as well. Next slide, please. The FY 2020 outlook is great. We've been reassuring our investors that we are on track. We've reaffirmed our guidance on revenue despite the macroeconomic challenges the world is facing through COVID-19. We have reaffirmed our guidance on EBITDA as well as net profit after tax. And back a few weeks ago when we announced our mid-year results, there was a material reduction in loss in both EBITDA and net profit after tax. In other words, we've been incredibly frugal.
Henry, you're going to have to leave it there so you can get across to your Q&A. You're right on time. Great start. Thank you for getting us underway in such good style. I'll let you get across to Q&A because I know the investors here in Australia are stacking up to talk with you. Thank you. It's now a pleasure to introduce yet again another presenter from the West Coast of the United States. Coming to us next from San Francisco is Sam Chandler, co-founder and CEO of Nitro Software Limited. Sam, the stage is yours.
Thanks so much, guys. And thank you for joining us today and giving us the chance to tell you a bit more about Nitro. I'm Sam Chandler, founder and CEO, and joining me for our Q&A session today will be Kurt Johnson, our chair and acting CFO. The agenda today is going to cover an intro to the company, our first half results and highlights, the outlook for the second half and the full year, and a bit more about the business strategy. Then we'll move to that Q&A session where we're looking forward to answering your questions about the company. So to introduce the company, the easiest way to describe Nitro is as a document productivity software company. We're specifically focused though on the most critical and prevalent documents in the enterprise. And so the key capabilities that we're enabling for our customers today are in the areas of PDF productivity, e-signatures, and document workflow intelligence. Think of things like contracts, forms, and typical knowledge worker and business processes. And the key results that we're delivering are very much appropriate for today's remote working world. We provide 100% digital document workflows. We accelerate and optimize those workflows, and we enable productivity anywhere, including from home. Moving on now to a brief history of the company. While we have 15 years of history, we have some distinct chapters or milestones. I started the company in Melbourne in 2005, and we were the first alternative to Adobe Acrobat at that time with the launch of Nitro Pro. We actually moved our global headquarters to San Francisco in 2009, and we subsequently also opened offices in London and Dublin. But perhaps the most important evolution for Nitro in the last 4 or 5 years has actually been our transformation to an enterprise software company with a multi-product strategy that also includes e-signing and document workflow intelligence. And it's this high-growth enterprise business that's been built entirely on a subscription revenue model that really led us to our IPO in December last year. Before we talk a bit more about the markets that we operate in and our product strategy, I do want to get you across a few key numbers that I think give you a sense of the current scale of the business, but also our future potential. Today, we have over 2 million licensed users, that is paid and licensed users, and over 11,000 business customers right around the world. We also count over 2/3 of the Fortune 500 as customers today. And in fact, we have 3 of the Fortune 10, ExxonMobil, United Healthcare, and a Berkshire Hathaway subsidiary. Some of you may have seen that Berkshire just announced their first investment in an enterprise software company yesterday. And so, Warren, if you're listening at the ASX conference today, we'd love to welcome you as a shareholder as well as a customer. But in terms of revenue, guys, we're not quite at Berkshire scale yet. We are forecasting just over $40 million. This is US dollars this year in 2020. We're a calendar fiscal. And we're also forecasting 57% growth in ARR or annual recurring revenue. We finished the first half with about $44 million US dollars in cash. And this is giving us really significant balance sheet strength, whether it's for organic or inorganic growth. But to set the scene a little bit for some discussion about our product strategy and lineup, I want to quickly talk about the digitization wave that Nitro is riding. We create software that drives digital transformation for customers around the world, but it's important to really understand how much opportunity still remains in this space, because when people say digitization, it conjures many things, but I think the key point here is that we are in the very early phases of the digital revolution for enterprise documents, very, very firmly in the first era. And this first era is characterized by just moving to digital. It's simply about eliminating paper and egregious costs and egregious inefficiencies. But more often than not, first era transformation is pretty mechanical. It's really just about replacing paper-based workflows with digital ones without necessarily making them significantly smarter. The second era, which we're starting to see glimpses of, is going to be characterized by more intelligence, including the use of advanced AI and machine learning technologies. And I think what we're going to see in that era is those mechanical workflows get a lot smarter, more efficient, more reliable, and human input, which is the greatest source of error in document workflows today, is going to be minimized, and computing power is going to be maximized. It's in the third era, though, where we believe the true promise of digital transformation is going to be realized. This is where intelligent workflows are going to be dominant. And we think Nitro and other vendors that can own large parts of the productivity and workflow stack, as it's called, will be the most successful. So I think our notion of a document in this era is going to be very different to the current paradigms. Documents are going to be a whole lot smarter. And we play right across all these eras. You know, Forrester assessed our serviceable addressable market in PDF productivity and e-signing alone at $5.5 billion US dollars. When we look out to the second and third eras of digitization, I think that market opportunity gets orders of magnitude larger again. So we think this is a very exciting space to be in. And so the solution we're delivering today and how it will evolve in the future very much maps to this macro wave of digitization. So what is it that we sell, right? It's basically the products you see here today, and more in the future. So what you see here is Nitro Pro for PDF productivity, Nitro Sign for e-signing, Nitro Analytics for BI or business intelligence, and all of these products are supported by our industry-leading customer success program. The core and standard offering that we have in the business today is our Nitro Productivity Suite. It bundles these products together into a single subscription. As of last quarter, though, we have also released Nitro Sign as a standalone offering. That's really as a result of the surging demand for re-signature solutions with everybody working remote. The big differences when you buy Nitro relative to the legacy or incumbent solutions that we are typically replacing or fighting for new market share with, it's a combination of things, but the differentiators you see here on this slide really include the ability to get multiple products and points of value from a single vendor, having products that are easier for IT to deploy and manage while being also simpler for end users to use and adopt. We've got our analytics capabilities that are truly unrivaled, you know, in this space and actually indeed in broader spaces. And we typically have a much lower cost of ownership relative to incumbent solutions. And of course, these capabilities are now proven in the largest companies in the world, often at very significant deployment scale. So customers like Exxon or Lloyd's or GE often have 20,000 employees or more using Nitro every single day. But rather than maybe just talking about those features or benefits, we'll maybe put these benefits in the customer's words. the first customer story you see here is a very large UK bank. They're a brand new customer who moved to Nitro in less than 45 days during Q2 at the very height of the COVID-19 pandemic. They had 50,000 employees go remote in a matter of days or weeks. You can see here pretty glowing praise from the office of the CIO. They actually replaced 99% of that Adobe legacy product with Nitro, and they literally did it in weeks. To do this and do it with high marks from management and users alike is a pretty rare thing. And I think it's testament to our product quality and the experience that our customer success team has now in deploying at scale, quickly in the largest organizations in the world. There's another spotlight here too I just want to show you quickly, which talks a bit more to the Nitro Sign opportunity and that emerging sort of second era around document productivity and workflow. And this is a customer who actually has been a long-time Nitro customer for many years, I think since 2013, and upgraded to the Nitro Suite to get e-signing. Almost all of their workforce, 95% went remote during the first half. Nitro Sign was deployed across all the critical contract and business workflows to ensure business continuity. And just like the bank, they're up and running super quickly. So I think the themes you're seeing here are, Nitro products are very powerful, easy to use, quick to deploy at scale, and supported by great customer service. So maybe now we'll switch gears to do a quick synopsis of first half results and highlights. So revenue in the first half, again, we're a calendar fiscal, was 19.1 million or 100% of our prospectus forecast, despite the COVID kind of sales pipeline disruptions. We had subscription revenue growing 60% year on year. ARR finished at 103% of plan, which was $600,000 above plan, and actually grew 57% year on year. And I think what you're seeing here in these numbers are the strong, scale and growth trends in the recurring revenue or subscription business, in particular driven by the success of the Nitro Productivity Suite and Nitro Sign. You can see here also a strong beat on EBITDA at negative 1.6 million. That was 1.4 million better than forecast, primarily due to COVID-related expense caution. On an adjusted basis, if we exclude the significant FX gains and losses in the period, the EBITDA loss was actually only 400,000. And I mentioned this earlier, but we finished the half with nearly 44 million in cash and no debt. So very proud of that first half, result and the efforts to achieve it. Moving to slide 13 now, maybe for some quick operational highlights. In terms of COVID, it's been a bit of a short-term disruption for us. It's evolved, though, into a positive new demand trend. And I think Nitro stands to benefit significantly over time. As a company, we're as productive, if not more productive, working entirely remote. And we are knowledge workers selling to other knowledge workers. So in many respects, remote work is the new normal. And so it's business as usual for Nitro, but with increasing demand for our products and services. And I mentioned earlier that we released Nitro Sign as a standalone product in Q2. We've made the product available at no cost through 2020 to help organizations navigate their transition to remote work, but also to build awareness and drive adoption. Right now, we're beating all of our internal metrics for this product, and we're super excited about its potential and just the potential for the e-signing category broadly. And then the final point on this slide, guys, is it was a very busy half for us for executive bench building. We hired a new CFO. She starts later this month. We've also appointed a chief product officer. He started a couple of months ago. A chief marketing officer. She just started. A global head of sales several months back. And that's just a handful of the new recruits. So very excited about this team that can help us scale this company, to the next level and well beyond. One thing I did want to point out quickly today, guys, because the evolution to a subscription business is such a key part of our story, is how subscription is now dominating our business sales today. You can see here on this slide, over 90% of our business sales by dollars in Q2 were subscription. And in the larger deals that make up the majority of those dollars in the half, 97% of all those deals were subscription, those above $10,000 of annual contract value. So very much a subscription business now and very much on the path to becoming 100% recurring revenue. And the revenue is coming from these kinds of customers that you can see here, right? We had RBS, NatWest, Big Four UK Bank join us during the half. Sandvik, one of Sweden's 10 largest companies. BP, Suncor, that's a TSX, a Toronto Stock Exchange 60 company. These guys all came on board during the half. We also had some very big customers renewing in the period, like GE, Grant Thornton, the German manufacturing giant, Continental, Exxon as well. So you can see our enterprise credentials, increasingly established, in almost every key market and all of our key verticals around the world. And guys, just maybe a couple more points on financial metrics before we talk about the outlook. Our prospectus forecast for the year is 24.4 million, but we expect to healthily beat it. We'll do it though also with strong SaaS metrics. So you've got a high renewal rate here, or basically the same as the gross dollar retention rate of 88%. We have a net revenue, or also known as a net dollar retention rate, of 118% and an LTV to CAC of 4.7 for the half. These numbers imply really strong retention and growth in the base and strong sales and marketing efficiency as well. So guys, I think before we head off to the Q&A session shortly, just a few slides here on our strategy and the outlook for the business. We talked earlier about the digitization wave that we're riding. We also talked about our current product lineup. What you can see here on this slide is that we're very much focused on executing a product vision to create a true productivity and workflow platform. We already have Nitro Pro, Nitro Sign, and Nitro Analytics, but there's going to be many more products added to that platform in the future. We're moving more into deep advanced workflow, document intelligence, security compliance, and more. And you can also see our integration set pretty rapidly expanding. You can see on this next slide, by the way, guys, the growth levers that we're focused on here, whether it's new customers, continuing that trend, or expansion in the base, or M&A, or new channels or geographies, there's a lot of runway here for growth. We're playing in some very large global markets already, and we're succeeding in many respects, but we have ambitions for dramatically larger scale. And so guys, I guess in closing, just to talk to the full year, second half and full year forecast, we've reaffirmed the 2020 prospectus forecast of $40.5 billion in revenue. We expect, as I said earlier, to beat pretty healthily the $24.4 million prospectus forecast for ARR. And while we didn't spend entirely the plan in the first half, we will catch up to that OPEX plan over the balance of the year. So thanks so much for your time today, guys. Really appreciate this opportunity to speak. And Kurt and I look forward to catching up with you shortly in the Q&A session. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Sam, for a great presentation and also for the heads up on Warren Buffett. I'm sure he's tuning in from Omaha. I'm going to let you and your colleague head across to the Q&A. Room so your attendees can go across and ask you some questions. Continuing the theme again from San Francisco, Russell Burke is CEO of Life360 Inc. and we welcome you to the stage. Thank you, Russell.
Thanks, Ian. Good morning. I'm delighted to be joining you at the ASX Small and Mid-Cap Conference. I'm presenting to you today, as Ian said, from San Francisco. However, as you can probably tell from the accent, I am Australian. Although I've lived and worked in the US for many years, I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to present to you today. For those unfamiliar with Life360, we're the world's leading safety service for families. The family is at the center of everything that we do, and this is what differentiates us from the products and services that we provide. You may know us through our mobile app, which is available in Australia and around the world. Here's a quick snapshot of the company. Life360 is headquartered in San Francisco with an employee base of around 200. We report our financials in US dollars under US GAAP. So please note that all references in this presentation to dollars are in fact to US dollars, unless we otherwise specify. Our CDIs are listed on the ASX under the ticker 360, and we have a market capitalization of around 650 million Australian. Our IPO took place in May 2019, raising around $76 million. And as of June 2020, we've got a net cash position of $58.4 million with no debt. Here's a snapshot of the Life360 business. At June 2020, we had 25 million monthly active users and 845,000 paying circles or subscribers, mainly in the US, but also across 195 countries and 13 languages. Our annualized monthly revenue based on June 2020 was close to 78 million. During the first half of calendar 2020, Life360 delivered normalized revenues of 38.7 million or a 57% year-on-year increase. Underlying EBITDA loss for the same period was 2.6 million, an 82% year-on-year improvement. This slide provides an overview of the market opportunity that we see for Life360. The pie chart shows that the US makes up 64% of the monthly active user base, with a very broad spread amongst other countries around the world. The chart on the right shows the penetration of our MAU base against the population of each country. Even in our most established market of the US, MAU penetration is still only 5%, with significantly lower penetration in other markets. Obviously, this highlights the considerable upside opportunity that lies ahead. And in addition, as you will see shortly, our new membership offerings actually broaden the addressable market that we are accessing. In the next couple of slides, I wanted to provide some insights into Life360's freemium business model. There are multiple benefits as well as costs to maintaining a free service. As you can see in the diagram on the slide, we're able to monetize our entire user base through indirect revenue, which includes data and lead generation revenue streams. Importantly, the free user base also operates as a top of the funnel for our paid subscriptions, which provide our direct revenue. We maintain engagement with our free user base for years, and they're therefore able to convert users into subscribers over a significant period of time with little incremental costs. In the first half of 2020, direct revenue contributed 73% of our total revenue across the international and US markets, with indirect contributing 27% of our total revenue. But the power of Life360's revenue retention model is displayed on this slide, where we focus on one quarterly user cohort with a long-term history, just as an example. The chart illustrates that revenue retention over time is much stronger than subscriber retention. This is due to the continuous refresh of free users into paid subscribers and the upsell of subscribers into higher price points. You can see that this occurs over an extended period of time, stretching beyond 27 months. The fact that net revenue retention for a user cohort is so dramatically higher than subscriber retention is what truly drives the long-term health of the business. The exact result will vary by cohort with different conditions, but the broad outcome is the same. This slide provides a long-term history of Life360's quarterly revenue and the EBITDA performance. The chart on the left shows that despite the lockdowns associated with COVID-19, revenue continued to increase quarter on quarter, reflecting the resilient nature of our subscription model. The chart on the right shows Life360's EBITDA margin profile. In the second quarter of 2020, we achieved a positive EBITDA margin for the first time. Much of this was due to our temporary pivot to a defensive posture in these uncertain times, where we really scaled back on our user acquisition marketing spend. We do expect this margin to come back down when conditions return to normal, because we're going to continue to invest to really drive long-term growth. However, the achievement of EBITDA profitability demonstrates the flexibility of our business model, and we're well positioned to weather the crisis, even though it's continuing longer than anyone initially anticipated. I spoke earlier about our direct and indirect revenue, and I wanted to provide some more detail on the drivers of these two revenue streams. The chart on the left shows the performance of our paying circles, or subscribers, which increased 21% year on year to 845,000. Despite the impact of COVID-19 in the first half, paying circles were still 2% ahead of December 2019, and we're proud that we demonstrated this full period growth in the face of difficult circumstances and a near complete pause in user acquisition spend. The chart on the right shows average revenue per paying circle, which increased around 12% year on year. US ARPPC continued to benefit from the shift to higher priced Driver Protect product subscription and a higher proportion of monthly versus annual subscribers. We do expect continued acceleration of ARPPC due to the new membership offering that I'll talk about shortly. As I mentioned earlier, we monetize our entire user base through indirect revenue, which includes data and lead generation revenue. Year-on-year revenue growth was strong. However, we did see impacts from COVID on some data customers, and our expectation is that growth will be flat in the second half. While data makes a valuable contribution, it's not our core focus. The market for high quality data partners is limited, and we're more focused on the ways in which we can use our data to really enhance our own internal product offerings. Our auto insurance lead generation partnership with Allstate launched in May 2019 and makes a monthly contribution of around $500,000. While COVID has impacted the pace of expansion, we do remain optimistic about this revenue opportunity in the longer term. I want to turn now to our membership model, which launched on time on June 30, with the full rollout achieved over the first 2 weeks of July. I should also highlight that at this time, our full membership offering is only available in the US market. Before I go into the detail of the membership model, I wanted to explain that this initiative is actually the culmination of more than 10 years in the evolution of the vision for the company. We put the 360 into the Life 360 name because our strategy has always been to be more than an app. Our goal is to provide a service that protects you physically while you're driving and in the cloud, all simultaneously. We use the proceeds of the IPO to fully execute what we've been envisaging since the company was founded. Prior to the membership launch, our product was focused on two life stages: families with teens and families with college-age kids. Our premium offering was very appealing to families at these specific life stages, where kids were becoming more independent and were on the road with other teens. What's exciting about the membership offering is that our reach expands significantly. ID theft is relevant to young adults who are becoming financially independent, and our SOS feature is tied to physical safety, which is relevant to a much broader array of people. As well as going older, our membership offering allows us to go younger with features like Family Safety Assist, which are highly relevant for younger families. Our driving features may not be relevant if your kids are not of driving age, but the 24/7 assistance is hugely useful if you're living with the chaos of younger kids and teens at home. We are seeing this offering as the beginning rather than the end of the range of valuable services that we can provide to families. There's an opportunity to roll out features into our offering and become a truly essential part of everyday life. Our goal is to become something that parents sign up for instinctively. Just as 20 years ago, people signed up for NRMA or RACV in Australia or the AAA in the US when they bought a car. There's a lot more detail on these products and services in the appendix to this presentation. This slide provides an overview of the tiering of our membership service. This was created to maximize both conversion and revenue. It supports our freemium model, where users can access a basic account for free, with premium options starting with silver at $4.99 all the way through to platinum at $19.99 a month. The tiering was based on considerable market research. Our current users were grandfathered into these tiers to minimize disruption to the existing base. Plus users received silver at no additional charge, and our Driver Protect subscribers received gold. The revenue benefits from this new model will largely come from new users as they take up the new premium tiers, so the revenue benefit will take some time to build. The value that our new membership model is providing is highlighted on this slide. As you can see on the left-hand side, subscribers would have to spend $256 a month for a family of four and subscribe to at least 8 different providers to match what we're offering at our platinum level. We're able to do this by leveraging mobile economics. We're able to grow organically through word of mouth and leverage our existing infrastructure to launch these services at a fraction of the cost of legacy incumbents. As a result, we're going to be disrupting these markets. I mentioned earlier that we achieved full rollout of our membership model in mid-July, and this slide gives you an idea of the first 4 months' performance. We have more than 40,000 new and upsell subscribers into the new membership tier, who now make up around 6% of our US subscriber base. Most exciting of all is the uplift in ARPPC being achieved by this new cohort, with a 33% increase compared to, with new subscribers in the first half of 2020. The table on this slide provides an overview of Life360's gross margin expectations across the new membership offering, US legacy and international subscribers, and our free users. Gross margin takes into account account holding costs, membership benefits, customer support, technology costs, and allocated salaries. For our three subscriber groups across membership, US legacy, and international, gross margins are between 85 and 95%. Taking into account the cost of serving our free users, overall gross margin is 65 to 70%. And then considering the cost of commissions, the contribution margin of our subscriber business is around 40 to 45%. And this doesn't include the higher margin data and lead generation revenues. So in conclusion, I wanted to summarize the ways in which membership will directly benefit Life360's most important financial drivers. As I highlighted earlier, there is a significant increase in the total addressable market. Our new features are relevant to families at all life stages. This broader offering provides a greater opportunity for premium conversion, and as I just showed you, a meaningful increase in average revenue per paying circle. Over time, we expect the longer relevant life cycle and substantially greater value will reduce churn. All of these factors combine to deliver significantly higher lifetime value and company revenue and underpin the long-term growth opportunity for the company. Thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to the Q&A session, but if you have any other follow-up questions, please feel free to visit our investor relations website at investors.life360.com. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Russell. And yes, great to hear that Aussie accent come to us from across the Pacific. We'll let you get off to Q&A. Our next presentation is from Saribar Jain, who's the Chief Executive at UrbanEyes.com Limited. Over to you, Saribar.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm Saurabh Jain. I'm the CEO at UrbanEyes. Delighted, obviously, to join you guys today. For those of you who don't know, UrbanEyes is the leading provider of a cloud SaaS platform. Two main areas, one is strata management and one is facilities management. My background, software engineer by trade, joined UrbanEyes back in August 2017. Started off as the chief commercial officer for the facilities division. When I came across UrbanEyes, I was working at Ventia, one of Australia's largest services business, and I was tasked with trying to consolidate all the different platforms that we had and ended up picking UrbanEyes. After the first implementation, which we did over in New Zealand, I ended up joining the company and became the CEO back in 2019. If you can jump on the next slide. So look, I'm going to cover three quick things today. I'm going to take you through a bit of an overview of our business. We've run through our financial results, and then I'll talk briefly around the outlook for next year. Great, next slide. So just a quick snapshot of our business. Look, we operate in about 15 different countries. We've got, you know, 330,000 apartments on our Strata platform, about 2,000 user facilities platform. 69% of our revenue comes from APAC. 27% comes from the Middle East, a bit in Africa. Middle East is probably one of our greatest growth markets right now. And probably the most important for me is our license fee revenue. That's our recurring revenue, is up at 81.4%. Next slide. So we provide a leading multi-tenanted cloud platform. Probably the five or six main things I'd always talk about is it's obviously SaaS, so it's a per user per month or per apartment per month fee. We have a broad product suite, so there's a lot that we can sell out to our customers. We invest a lot in analytics and AI, and that's what we do around trying to automate a lot of the manual processes people do around strata management or facilities management. We spend a lot of money on the intuitive user interface because we are in a kind of a funny market space where, especially on the strata side here in Australia, we're the only cloud platform. So we're the only one with a modern web interface and modern mobile apps. And we offer an integrated solution of strata management and facilities management. So you can do the financial aspect of running a Strata complex, and you can do all the kind of the day-to-day aspects of running our work orders and trade stuff. Okay, next slide. So this kind of touches on the two platforms that we have with a bit of a side-by-side comparison. On the Strata side, I mean, think about it as like a core accounting system. So we do all the financial side, all the levies, all the banking. If you ever go to a Strata meeting, all those votings that you have to do, all the fees, and all the financial banking legislative requirements you need to run a Strata complex. On the other side, for the facility, so we offer a tool for facilities management outsourcing firms and larger asset owners. So that's around making sure you're compliant, around all your planned maintenance, managing all your trade staff, all the asset capture, and then all the reporting and analytics, all the data that comes along with doing that as well. Great, next slide. So this slide kind of talks about all the key features that we have in the Strata platform. So as I said, it's a core accounting system. We do all the invoicing, or the meeting management, or the work order management. So when something breaks in a Strata complex, or any kind of residential complex, we're the system that goes and gets someone to come and fix that. All the document management, so all the docs that get generated. And then we have what's unique to us is all the community portals, all the interaction. So if you're in Australia, good chance you'll be on our platform. You can download our mobile app, you can chat with your Strata manager, you can approve invoices, you can view your levy ledger. Over in the Middle East, you can pay through our app as well. So it's a nice kind of different way to interact with the body corporate or with the Strata manager. And fundamentally, it's all about kind of reducing the admin. So generally, when Strata managers use our platform, they'll save 20-30% in their admin effort, and they'll obviously give much, much better interaction back to their customers. Got a couple of new products we're launching this year around the automation side of things. So we've got a printing solution and a paperless accounts payable solution. And like any good cloud platform, we've got a lot of open APIs and integrations. Next slide. On the facilities management platform. So look, I mean, the main thing that customers benefit from here is it's reduced paperwork and admin costs. So really you want to be getting 20-30% headcount reduction with our platform. The way we do that is we absolutely bet the farm on AI and automation, and we invest a lot in that area. And fundamentally, it's all about providing transparency as to what's happening. You know, we want to streamline communication through our mobile apps with trade staff or people that are on site working on assets. We manage all the 10-year OPEX CAPEX plans. So often if you've got a large property portfolio, so for example, we do probably about half the electricity grids in Australia. So it helps them understand, look, over 10 years, what will actually cost to manage this portfolio. Awesome, next slide. Now, the great thing about the facilities product, and this is why we've had, you know, the fantastic growth we've had, I mean, we grew 58% last year in terms of license revenue, is we have a really, really strong network effect. So the way it works is we sign up the facilities management outsourcing firm on the top. So we've got about 30 odd of them right now. They'll win many, many contracts. So every time they win some work, they obviously buy our license fees and whatnot. And then they'll tell their subbies or mandate to their subbies that they have to sign up onto the platform. So it's a brilliant model. I've got a very, very low cost to acquire customers. And every time we do, we just get a lot of organic growth. We don't need to go out and chase the work, albeit we do chase that as well. Great, next slide. In terms of the customer lifecycle, I mean, if I start off with the Strata platform, so look, it takes about 1 to 6 months to convert a customer, about 3 to 9 months to migrate them onto our platform. Look, it's one of those things, I know, it's like going from MYOB to Xero. It's a core financial system migration, so there's a lot of work required to do that. And we have some really clever tools to help automate that process, and there we get to charge per lot. So every apartment on our platform, we charge a fee. On the facility side, slightly longer sales cycle because it's a bit more enterprise sales because we go after more the outsourcers or the large asset owners. But once they're on, it's a much quicker implementation, about 1 to 3 months. And there we get to charge our per user per month. So as more trade staff get onto our platform, as each of these outsourcers grow, they kind of naturally extend out the license fee with us as well. Support obviously plays a key role in everything that we do. So we have invested a lot over the last year. So we do offer, you know, support from, you know, 7 a.m. to 1 a.m. across Australia now. And again, we'll probably build out a lot more of that in the coming future as well. Next slide. Great. So a bit around some of the macro trends. So look, the good thing about being in Australia, we're probably the most regulated country in the entire world. So there's a lot of regulation around strata complexes, facilities management, especially with COVID and cleanliness and compliance. So that's kind of pushing people to more like platforms like ours. We can scale our platform across multiple countries. As I said, we're in about 15 different countries now, throughout Asia, New Zealand. We're in South Africa, the Middle East, in about probably five, six countries there. Customers in the UK as well. There's a real trend towards outsourcing facilities management. So a lot of the property owners, they push that work out to outsourcers that use our platform. In the Middle East, we get a lot of people demanding both of our platforms together. So almost every deal we sign up there, they buy both of our systems, the facilities and the strata. And look, for a company like us, COVID has given us a good tailwind. You know, as people try to move to the cloud, they get away from a lot of the in-house legacy tech. What's unique about us? I mean, it's a cloud-based system. It's like any other one out there. I mean, we've got 42 developers. So we do push out a lot of new features. So we push out about, 20, 30 new features every fortnight. Over the last 12 months, we've had 100% customer retention. I mean, it's kind of hard to get in, hard to get out. And we plan to keep continuing to expand out to new markets across our customer base. And more so as our customers pull us into new markets, we get a lot of that network effect I touched on. Probably the most unique thing is, for whatever reason, we're the only system that does both together, the facilities management and the strata management, which are kind of really interlinked. And we've started offering lots of third-party platforms into our product suite, which actually we clip the ticket on the way through and helps us push up the margin. Next slide. A bit around the financial results. Look, it's been a good year. I mean, revenue's been up, 19.5%, mostly driven by the license fee revenue, which is up 28.3%. We've kept our costs under control. Obviously, EBITDA's improved. Cash burn, before we were burning through 72K per month, now we're down to 154,000. And we've got plenty of cash in the bank with about $4.5 million cash, which included 2.2 mil institutional placement during the year. In terms of the revenue metrics, license fees are up. In terms of recurring revenue, up to 81%. ARR grew up 15. Backlog, so that's customers that have signed up that hadn't gone live last year, that's gone down as they've kind of liquidated into ARR. And various user numbers are up as well. Right, next slide. So probably the key ones I touch on again was obviously license fee growth is up, which has been great for us. ARR is up. We won a large contract probably a number of years ago with a company called Pico here in Australia. They're the country's largest strata manager. So we've been busy really implementing that as part of our strata division. So we finished off Victoria last year. On the 1st of August, we finished off Queensland, which was after these results got published. And we're going to be working on New South Wales over the next fin year, over, sorry, over this fin year. And that will give us about another $1.3 million of recurring revenue, which will probably flow mostly straight to the bottom line. Like any good SaaS company, we have negative working capital. So every time we sign up a customer, they kind of fund our future growth. Most of our customers pay annually, with a couple paying quarterly in advance. And that cash has helped us invest in driving the ARR. Driving annualized recurring revenue, strong backlog, $1.8 million worth of customers that have already signed up that we're busy implementing. And because, as I said, there's been no material impact due to COVID. I mean, what we did find kind of March, April, was there a bit of a slowdown in the decision-making process, but that's kind of really picked up since. Great, next slide. So in terms of the actual growth across the different divisions, look, if I look at Strata, it's been steadily growing. I mean, what I've asked the team to do since I got CEO gig back in January 2019 is really just buckle down and sort out this one large implementation for this customer. And I'm quite happy with the results and looking forward to that project finishing and that 1.4 moving from backlog to ARR. Facilities has been absolutely outstanding. I mean, it's tripled over the last 2 years. It's 10x what it was 3 years ago. And the reason is, as I touched on before, we've got a lot of network growth. We don't need to actively go out and seek customers. Obviously, we do that, but a lot of customers kind of just naturally up their license fees as they grow as companies. Awesome. Next slide. Look, this shows our monthly cash burn quarter by quarter. So, look, I mean, it's been amazing. It's our best cash result. I mean, we were cash flow positive, albeit we got a few little free kickers from the government around COVID with some of the pay-as-you-go tax and the payroll tax. I mean, we didn't apply or wouldn't be eligible for JobKeeper. But the core underlying cash burn is probably about 75K per month when you take back those deferrals and those free kicks. And we're kind of happy with that cash burn as we kind of invest a lot more in sales and marketing. And as I said, on the 1st of July, we had about $4.5 million of cash in the bank. So we've got plenty of runway ahead of us. Next slide. So look, I mean, probably the most attractive part of the business to me is our net working capital. So that's gone over the last couple of years from positive $1.5 million down to a negative $1 million. So what that means is, you know, we've got $2.6 million worth of cash in our bank that customers have actually prepaid versus only 1.6 that customers owe us. So it's a great, 1.6 that we owe customers. So it's a great way to fund growth. So fundamentally, the quicker we grow, the more cash that we get as customers, tend to pay annually in advance, for which we give them a bit of a discount for. So they kind of pay for 10 months and they get 2 months for free. Awesome, next slide. So let me start talking about the outlook. So on the Strata side, I mean, the core thing for us to do is to finish this large peak implementation with that major customer that I mentioned, and that will drop 1.3 mil of ARR. We're investing a lot more on sales and marketing. So we've put on a whole bunch of new salespeople, a full-time marketing manager, kind of 3x the marketing budget, which will kind of give us further improvements to working capital. And fundamentally, I mean, we're a tech company, I'm a software engineer by trade. It's about making sure the product's fantastic. And that's what the 42 devs do day in, day out. And that's why we have, 0% customer churn, or we did over the last 12 months, which will really increase the stickiness of our existing customers and help grow the ARR for new customers. Well, that was it from my side. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to answering any questions in the Q&A session.
Great. Thank you, Saribar. We'll let you head off to your Q&A session. Just while I have you with Q&A, our presenter before, Saribar Russell from Life360, his Q&A did go ahead, but we had a small problem with the broadcast. What we've been able to do is record it, and we're currently editing it. So during the break over lunchtime before we come back at 2 o'clock, you'll be able to go back into the Q&A session for Life360, and you'll be able to hear the full Q&A that was asked of Russell from your questions and how he has responded to them. So you won't miss a thing there if you wish to do that through the break up till 2 o'clock. So we're going to move on to the next presentation, which comes to us from Christian Damstra, whose name appears in the company name, Damstra Holdings. So over to you, CEO Christian Damstra.
Thank you very much. Christian Damstra here, CEO of Damstra Technology, and really pleased to be given the opportunity to present to everyone today. For those of you that don't know much about Damstra, we provide a software as a service technology to help keep people safe on the worksite. So what that really means is everything from your skills, your competencies, your training, your e-learning, incident and hazard management, access control, fatigue management, alcohol testing, everything effectively from end to end that's about the individual working on that site. If we could just skip through to slide number 5 for me, we'll get through the disclaimers there. That would be great. We had a really outstanding last financial year. Extremely proud of how we've done that. $23.5 million of revenue, up from $16 million in the previous period, 46.6% growth, 90.7% annual recurring revenue, and less than 0.5% client revenue churn. 30% increase in total R&D spend, and $6.8 million pro forma EBITDA. From there, of course, we've got the 279 clients operating over 404,000 users across 11 countries at this particular point in time. So really fantastic, strong financial year. If we can just step forward to the next slide, please. Financial year 20 highlights, strong outcomes, as I said previously, gross margin up, EBITDA up, revenue and other income growth of 47% versus the previous year, and a 3-year CAGR of 42%. We've had limited impact from COVID-19. Certainly, we've seen a slowdown in some of the rollouts and things like that on our remote sites in South America and Africa, but certainly no major changes to our workspace from that, other than a tailwind, which I'll talk about a little later. If we can go to the next slide, please. Next one. Yep. Significant achievements across the four core growth pillars, so organic growth, product and technology, our partnership model, and of course our strategic acquisitions, which has always been part of our growth opportunity. We've seen substantial new customer wins from our clients in the US and Southeast Asia, to the point that we've identified Southeast Asia being a new market for us in the coming period. So we're working very hard on that. New verticals in education and finance sector, and of course our core clients in the construction sector are rolling out more and more components of our system every single day. A lot of cross-selling to existing customers, which I'll talk about in a future slide, from the different acquisitions and the new software that we've been building, has seen us achieve these fantastic results last year. Innovation, structural increase in total R&D to 30% across this year compared to last. And that increase in R&D spend, about 20% of that's been on bringing in the different organizations that we've acquired and following our philosophy of one code base, one platform, one seamless system for our customers. The remainder of that R&D is spent on new solutions, user experience, user interface, and making sure that we've got the latest technology and security supporting our customers. We've signed up to new US partners, Zavaro and GAI. We're really excited about what they're bringing to the mix with over 200 presentations done across their network in the last 2 months alone. We're certainly focusing very heavily on the United States and our partner network in that region. TechnologyOne going along extremely well. They've got a number of people on our e-learning platform now, and they're targeting 75 actual customers on our system by the end of financial year 21, and they're well on track to achieve that. Investing in North America, of course, as I mentioned before, we also have our two new senior VPs started there now to really ramp up the sales across North America and help us achieve our international growth that we're targeting of currently 20% international growth last year. And we're certainly targeting in future periods, we see an opportunity in a number of years where international revenue will be higher than domestic. Of course, our strategic acquisitions of Scenario, APE Mobile, and Smart Asset, they're now integrated. We're still doing a bit of work on Smart Asset. That's going extremely well, and we're seeing cross-sell across all of those platforms, but a large amount of cross-sell across the APE Mobile platform. If we could move to the next slide, please. Certainly, we've seen some industry tailwinds. COVID-19 is one of those tailwinds. Of course, we reacted very quickly when COVID came out with our temperature sensing system, as well as our presence control. When you add that on top of our base product of track, manage, educate, and protect, all those things line up extremely well for customers looking to protect their workforce during and after COVID-19. So we've been seeing a lot of tailwind there, particularly around the sustainability aspect of what Dantra can do for your business moving forward. So we're really pleased that that's driving us in to this current financial period. Next slide, please. We've expanded our platform in the last financial year. I spoke about the 30% R&D spend. You can see there that we've added over 14 fully integrated products, with many of those built in-house. Some of those were bolt-ons from our acquired organizations, and we've highlighted that on that slide. But certainly, we've grown that product pipeline. We've proven the capability to integrate the products and our modules fast. We brought our temperature sensing system to the market in under 2 months, and some people may have noticed we did a release today because we're getting great early take-up on that product, and that's certainly driving some great revenue increases at this point in time. And we see that demand not slowing down at this point in time. So that's fantastic. Particularly, as I said before, sustainability. Sustainability is the key to those solutions. Next slide, please. Our integrated platform replaces many, many different standalone solutions. There's a lot of standalone solution providers out there who might offer a access control system or a visitor management system or a paperless form system. But where the real power and the value in the platform comes in is by having that entire platform integrated and linked, and not having to go out through different APIs and those things to make everything work. We, of course, are not a rip and replace company. If you have systems that you like, we have a full REST API layer, We have many different ways of integrating with systems, and today we integrate with over 100 different products, including SAP, Oracle, Honeywell, and many others based on our clients' needs. Next slide, please. This is a case study of one of our construction customers. I mentioned very briefly before that we're seeing a lot of cross-selling happening across our customers, and I just wanted to point this one out in particular. So when they started back with us in financial year 18, they had our base platform, our workforce management with access control and plant mobilization. In financial year 19, we finished deploying those items, and certainly they ramped up their numbers of people. So we saw automatic revenue growth from that. But you can see the uptick in financial year 20 because they've added extra products from our platform. They've added our Velpic LMS system, so our e-learning system. They've added HSE from our APE Mobile acquisition, which is now our SAM paperless system. They've actually just recently, in the last few months, added the fever detection and mobile login to help them counteract the demands of COVID-19 on their business moving forward. And already we're looking at potential additions in the coming period from our lone worker system, of course, that we're working on with our Vault acquisition, which I'll talk about shortly, and even more HSE digital forms rolling out to the organisation. But that shows you how we can grow within an existing customer extremely positively across the board. And by continually growing the product and offering that from that base platform is extremely powerful. Next slide, please. We talked about our fever scanning and the ability to do facial recognition in under a second and log people into site and know what their temperature is at all times. As I said before, this is something that we picked up, we developed it, and we rolled it out in under 2 months. And we now have hundreds of units in the field, and we're really pleased with the take up of that, including new areas for us of education. So we moved into education in Colorado. A private school has that system installed. Every single student, every single teacher, every single day, they record their temperature to make sure that they're doing everything they possibly can to keep COVID-19 out of their facilities. Next slide, please. And of course, our paperless form system. We've certainly seen a lot of cross-selling. I showed that before on that construction client. They're not the only ones who are doing that. We've got a customer who is, we've cross-sold paperless forms into, and they're saving now, are doing over 1.3 million forms per month. And that's saving of approximately 5 minutes of manual data entry per form across 20 different sites. This is a time saving of over 200,000 hours per year. Now, the real key to them was not so much the paperless form, as I said before, it's about the full integration with the platform. So what they're doing on that form is linked in and flowing automatically into the people's profiles. It's automatically alerting them if that person hasn't got the right skills to do that task when they're completing their permit. There's so many advantages of having it all in that platform, and that's what that customer is seeing. Next slide, please. RFID plant tracking, built in-house solution for a customer, over 400 daily truck movements. This product is saving that organization more than $30,000 a month in manual entry. This is another product that we developed in a rapid time frame based on customer needs. And that's why we have a fantastic development team. And we're spending 30% on R&D every year because we want to continue to bring these cutting edge technologies to our clients as part of the base platform every single day of the year. Next slide, please. As we said before, M&A is a core strategy to generate value. It's a very fragmented workplace, that environment that we work in, I should say. So we are always looking at M&A. What do we look for in acquisition target? Three core principles: product, people, it's got to be commercialized. And then, of course, geographic organization. Do they have geographic revenue, geographic location? And what can we do with that organization by bringing it into the Dampster group? And of course, our goals are to make any company cash flow generative and accretive to our business within 3 months of bringing them into the mix. A couple of small ones we've done there, of course, Scenario, APE and Smart Asset, and we'll focus on Vault in just a moment. Next slide, please. Improving gross margin. We have invested going into our IPO. We invested very heavily in ERP systems, back office, and technology to make sure all of our global offices were set up for success with the right tools. And of course, what we're seeing now is our gross margin improvement because we've got a very flat and stable cost base. So we're really pleased to see that that is now working in our favor. Next slide, please. Increasing that operating leverage based on that fixed cost base that we just spoke about, resulting in significant operating leverage at the EBITDA level. Next slide, please. Positive cash flow generative, and certainly our statutory cash flow bridge is there if you've got any further details you'd like there, but we'll move on to the next slide, please. Next slide. Acquisition of Vault Intelligence. I'm sure most people would be aware that we announced that we're working on the acquisition of Vault Intelligence. That has now been approved by the federal court, and we're moving forward to shareholder votes and all those types of things. And we're really pleased and happy with how that's been progressing. We see Vault as a fantastic strategic opportunity for us based on those three core principles of why we acquire organizations. And certainly the main one there is product. Their solo product is extremely well advanced. It's not a product that we had. It's a product that we have customers speak to us about. And we see a lot of cross-selling synergies between the two organizations. And we're very well organized and planned that when we hopefully get the approval and the final sign-off by the shareholders in October, we'll be able to hit the ground running and create some great benefits there. Next slide, please. I talked about our Vault a little bit, so we might just skip forward. Next slide, please. The combined group footprint sees us operating in over 11 countries, over 500 clients with over 210 employees in 13 offices. So some real positive numbers there. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, delivering on the strategy is what we've been doing. Record result, growing clients and users, new product innovation, position for our US growth, strategic acquisitions, and of course, increased investment in R&D. Next slide, please. For us, it's all about the future. So we're investing for the future. And as you know, our guidance is 33 to 35 million. We're going to see an increase in numbers. Our underlying business is extremely strong and solid. We're really pleased with the way it's performing. We've got a lot of cross-sell opportunities with the acquisitions we've done, as well as our new products. And of course, we're looking to complete Vault in October. I'll call that to an end there and say thank you very much for listening to us today, and look forward to talking to you further.
Great. Thank you, Christian, for that presentation. We're going to let you head over to the Q&A room now. Now, to bring us home for our last session for this morning is Jeremy Wells, CEO of Whisper Limited. Jeremy, the stage is yours.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us to discuss Whisper. I'll start with a quick overview of Whisper before taking you through our FY20 performance, our first year as a listed company. I'll also detail the key growth drivers for our business, including the long-term digital transformational trend. I'll finish with our growth strategy and expectations for FY21. And of course, you'll have opportunities to ask questions in the Q&A room. Next slide. Whisper is a communication workflow platform that automates interactions between organizations and people to ensure stakeholders receive accurate, timely, and useful insights through the channels those stakeholders prefer to use. We simplify the management of the complex communications ecosystem. The need for our services is universal across industry sectors and countries, and is only increasing as organizations shift to more remote operations and digital business processes, or the digitization of business processes. We're now producing 1.5 billion interactions for our 630 blue chip customers and their 55 million unique stakeholders each year. We've demonstrated product market fit with 11,000 use cases across 60 countries. And we're servicing this global client base from our 10 offices in three regions, 24/7, 365 days a year. Next slide. While our platform enables our customers to solve thousands of complex communications challenges, it's primarily used for business coordination to internal stakeholders, enhanced customer engagement, and crisis communications. It utilizes data-driven insights to deliver contextually relevant and personalized engagement with stakeholders at scale and across multiple delivery channels. On the left, you see the traditional way of delivering these services. They're not channel agnostic. They're hard to build, expensive, take time. Adoption rates are patchy, and they suffer from rapid app abandonment. On the right, you see how the Whisper automated workflow platform allows interactions with stakeholders at the right time on the right device with useful and actionable information. In the new normal, our platform is increasingly being used to facilitate digital transformation within organizations. It does this by automating manual processes and improving customer engagement through digital channels. I'll provide more detail on this later. Next slide. Our customers tell us that our proven communications experience over two decades, combined with our low-code, no-code capability, on-demand capability and easy integration with existing IT systems are real differentiators for us. We have a long-term product roadmap strategy, and we're investing in the development of innovative new communications technologies and enhanced platform intelligence to ensure we're able to keep meeting our customers' evolving needs. Add to that, fast development capability, cost-effective infrastructure and service delivery, repeatability and reliable process automation that the platform offers, and you have a formidable product that can scale to address our global market opportunity. Next slide. We partner with established local brands to cost-effectively acquire new customers and enter new markets. Channel partners collectively account for around 3/4 of our revenue and are key to our go-to-market strategy in all three regions. You can see our key channel partners listed here. Telstra is our main channel partner in Australia, while in Asia we have telcos StarHub and Indosat. In the US, our channel partners are more contemporary and include AWS, Vonage, and Nexmo. They all have complementary strengths that we can harness, leading to more diverse sales opportunities and revenue streams. Next slide. We're targeting a significant global market opportunity with our communications workflow platform. The communications platform as a service, or CPaaS market, is growing at a CAGR of 35%. A WCaaS market, which management believe is similar, will reach $8 billion in 4 years. We're continuing to invest in platform innovation and people to ensure the company can scale to capitalize on this market opportunity. Next slide. Moving to our financial performance in FY20. In our first year as a listed company, we met or outperformed all key FY20 prospectus forecasts. Annualized recurring revenue is a key metric for our SaaS business model, providing future revenue surety. In FY20, our ARR increased 34% year on year from $31.5 million in FY19 to $42.2 million at June 2020. Revenues of $39.1 million were up 25.5% on the same period last year, with Asia and Australasia being the main growth drivers, with revenues up 44% and 24% respectively. While the majority of this revenue growth came from our existing customer base, increased demand for communication software for COVID-19 and digital transformation projects delivered record net new customer growth in the second half of FY20. This brings total customer numbers to just over 630. The key to these new customer wins has been our ability to quickly deploy communications capabilities, often within a matter of hours, as well as changing buying behaviors with faster decisions and reduced red tape. It's important to note that these new customers have yet to have a material impact on revenues and ARR. Other financial highlights include EBITDA improved 50% over FY19 and was $2.1 million ahead of prospectus forecasts. Gross margins were in line with expectations at 62.5%. Next slide. Our business is built on strong underlying recurring revenue streams with customer revenue retention of 24.1%, best in class. As you can see, our customers are generally long-term and doing more with our platform at an ever-increasing rate. While our new customers typically implement Whisper to solve a single communications challenge, once they begin using our software, we become embedded in their operational processes and they use the platform for other use cases. I'll show you an example of that shortly. Next slide. This slide shows the impact to monthly recurring revenues when customers implement more use cases. Each row shows how we've increased average spend for each customer cohort over the last four reporting periods. The second and third rows highlight how we're increasing the number of high-value customers who are using the platform for more use cases. You'll see the number of customers using the platform for four or more use cases has increased 93% since the start of FY19, while the average monthly recurring revenue of these high-value customers has also increased significantly, with year-on-year growth of 47% to just over $23,000 per customer per month. Next slide. George Weston Foods is a good example of a customer who has significantly increased their platform usage over the past few years. George Weston Foods started using Whisper for business continuity planning in 2017. Since then, the use cases have increased almost tenfold as the company fast-tracked their digitization plans to streamline operational processes over the last year. Among the new use cases are product shortage notifications, company updates, HR check-ins, and remote and lone worker. The experience of George Weston Foods is not a one-off. Over the last few months, we've seen years-long digital transformation roadmaps for our customers compressed into months and quarters in order to adapt to the new normal as a result of COVID-19. Next slide. These macro communication trends provide significant short and long-term growth opportunities for Whisper. For many years, businesses have not had urgency when it came to going digital. However, COVID-19 and more remote operations has now made it a necessity. It's evolved from a small tick box on a balanced scorecard to a top business priority. Many companies have shifted their focus to digital transformation and are looking for solutions that are capable of embedding intelligence into business operations, automating more effective operational processes, and transforming their engagement with staff, customers, and their communities, much like what we saw with George Weston Foods. Companies are increasing their digital transformation budgets, with projects being accelerated by years. Next slide. Digital transformation has become the primary driver of productivity, automating manual processes and streamlining business operations. In addition to cost savings, this automation enables more effective use of resources and lowers the risk of user error. Traditional call center operations are increasingly incorporating digital streams to improve response times and redirect call volumes. Next slide. As one of the largest life insurance companies in Asia, AIA Group Singapore leveraged our workflow automation capabilities to digitize its customer communications. Around 60% of its more than 16 million members now receive notifications and e-statements electronically through Whisper, significantly reducing the company's reliance on paper-based communications. AIA's use of Whisper to send contextually relevant and personalized electronic communications to customers has increased engagement, with the platform now used by multiple AIA teams and business units for a range of communications, including customer feedback and Net Promoter Score automation. Next slide. The COVID-19 crisis makes what we thought would be a future digital world a challenge for organizations to address today. Digital channels are becoming the main, in some cases, the sole customer engagement model. Leveraging our technology, our customers are able to utilize data-driven insights to improve their customer experience with faster response times and a consistent brand experience across multiple communications channels. Our easy-to-use software is generating substantial value for our customers, delivering superior business outcomes and improving customer retention ratios and user satisfaction. Next slide. Singapore Telco M1 is a good example of a customer who used Whisper to transform its customer communications structure and automate internal and quite complex sign-off processes. This digitization enabled M1 to standardize its customer communications, improve response times, and enhance its customer targeting capabilities. M1's digital transformation using Whisper increased customer engagement levels from 20% to 80%. Next slide. The next slide shows the size of the global digital transformation market, which is growing at a CAGR of 22.5% and is expected to hit US $1.4 trillion by 2027. Digital transformation is an enduring trend and already accounts for the majority of global information and technology investment. It will continue to drive Wisper's platform utilization for many customers and for many years to come. Next slide. To address these significant market opportunities, we're investing heavily in platform innovation and increasing our data-driven intelligence capabilities. Our five-year product roadmap will see us build real defensible intellectual property in Wisper grounded on three key concepts: prediction, detection, and automation. Prediction is where we build features that can see around corners to save our customers wasted effort. We can use prediction to stop our customers sending messages to people about trains being late if the recipient isn't catching a train that day. Detection is about seeing something as it happens and helping customers avoid making mistakes, such as detecting if a message is poorly written or has a spelling mistake before they send it. And finally, automation. Increased automation will enable our customers to extract value faster. This includes automating the setup of accounts, on the onboarding process, message sending and receiving, leveraging off our powerful workflows. New products are being introduced to include conversational messaging, smart scheduling, intelligent message design capabilities, as well as significantly improved insights into individual recipient preferences. Next slide. Turning to our growth strategy, we have many growth drivers in place to increase our market penetration. We continue to utilize our established channel partners to cost effectively acquire new customers and expand our footprint in ANZ, Asia, and North America. We're continuing to diversify our channel partners to increase our product offering and drive platform adoption. And lastly, we're continuing to increase platform usage with our existing customer base with new functionality, innovation, and a digital direct strategy. Next slide. Slide 19 shows our growth expectations for FY21. New customer acquisitions in the second half of the year has created a momentum in the business, with these customers to have a material impact on revenues in FY21 and beyond. Revenue and ARR are both expected to increase by 21 to 30%, while EBITDA will improve 14 to 35% over FY20 figures. We're also increasing our R&D investment by about 8 to 15% to an excess of 9 million. Next slide. Before we finish, a quick recap on why Wisper exists. Put simply, we want to change the way the world communicates. Next slide. We can see a world in the near future where organizations can communicate like people. We want to humanize the way organizations communicate with their stakeholders. Next slide. We want to do this because we believe value is created when people are engaged. Next slide. So our promise to our customers is that we enable them to master connection and engagement with other people at scale. Next slide. Thanks for joining us on the Wisper Journey. I think we've got to go now to the...
Thank you, Jeremy, for bringing us up to the end of our morning session.